not speaking only to ICT engineers. So
okay, I'm a chemical engineer.
Okay, chemical. Okay, still Polytechnic, because I was wondering if there were people also from the University of Torino, but maybe there are. The other attendants are from Polytechnico also?
I think no.
I don't know. Welcome. So you are, can you tell me which is your background, just to know?
I'm a building engineer.
Building engineer, okay. You know that theoretically I was asked to speak about wireless communication today, which is actually something that is has a strong technical, ICT technical content. But since they anticipated to me that the idea was to show what you can do with the wireless communication on the side of a social application, I won't speak about technology. I will just leave the floor for the last 20-25 minutes to my researchers, Mattia and Giovanni, who will show you, but mainly with practical instruments, something that we have developed in the lab in order to work mainly on social innovation, using technology but to support the social innovation. So. Now it is 10:10. How long should we wait for the missing ones, or should they start?
I think we can start.
We can start. Okay. So theoretically, all of you are Italian, correct? But we are we have to speak English because of the registration.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
Thanks.
No problem. So. First of all, let me introduce myself. I am. I work in that building, which is the building where the electronic and telecommunication department of the Politecnico is hosted. And in practice, I am obviously a professor here in the Politecnico, but also director of the research lab, which is called XN Labs, where basically we do research on wireless communication. Take into account all the possible aspects of the wireless communication in our work, starting from the hardware. But it is not only hardware, because when you deal with the internet, with the ITs, one thing is the hardware, and then you need also a network, a platform, to transfer the data from the hardware, from your hardware, for example, your mobile, to the base station, and then to the mobile of another person. So you need also to set up the whole internet or, in general, network architecture, and this is something that we do also in the lab. So we work on the electronics, meaning hardware. We work on telecommunication, meaning the network, and obviously nothing in the world can survive without informatics, so we have also part of the activities that is related to informatics, both for the firmware and also for the network management and for everything. For example, two researchers that are here today, Mattia and Giovanni, one is electronics and the other is informatics, just to show you that the activity in the lab is very multidisciplinary. The thing I'm going to tell you is that in our labs we have tried to do, the labs now they are 13 years old, they were founded in 2004. We try to work, to use technology mainly to develop applications that can have a social impact. Everything in the world can have a social impact, but we try to focus on particular applications that might have a strong social impact compared to other ones. So we have two lines of research. One is actually we don't see very well because of the lights. I don't know if this. What do you think if we take down? Yes, there should be. Anyhow, You see that this is a picture that represents the lab where you see an island, you see a mountain, should see an island, a mountain, a forest, and a desert. And this picture that is taking together these four natural elements represents the part of the lab that is dedicated to bring internet connectivity worldwide in places that are normally called digitally divided places. When we started in 2004, we had an idea to bring some experiments in very remote areas in the world, so we were thinking to develop internet infrastructures in places where normal internet operators are not capable to provide any service because there is not an economical revenue, but in general, this is something that we have done, not only in the world, we have worked on this also in our country, and especially in the region which is very close to here. This is one part of the activities that are done in the lab. The other part is this one, and it is related to the development of specific hardware that might have a specific application which is normally not founded off the shelf. For example, the object that you see here that I have in my hand is a camera. We will show you with details with the real hardware after. And it is used in the vineyards to monitor the possible infections from diseases in order to avoid the use of chemicals. So basically to improve sustainability in agriculture. This is something that it is possible to do thanks to the use of wireless communication, to the use of the so-called Internet of Things, that is capable to monitor continuously the plants, the cultivations, and to allow you, in a way, to do this permissive monitoring, so to bring the farmer in the fields, even if he's not there. Thanks to the use of the technology, we have a virtual presence in the fields, and thanks to this virtual presence, it is possible to reduce the use of the chemicals, so basically to improve sustainability of the product. This is an example of what I call wireless for social innovation, because in a way it is something that is helping improving the capabilities of a more natural production, so in a way it is obviously a social innovation. So, basically, from the side of the so-called hardware, social innovation, we have developed in our lab three major projects in the course of 13 years. One is this one, as I told you, XMCAM. Another one was called the Snowhound, which is a device that uses wireless technology in order to reduce the risk of avalanches and to predict the avalanches. The third one is a device that we have developed in order to use wireless technology to investigate water pipelines and to understand if there might be leakages, so to reduce or at least to compact the cost for searching water leakages in aqueduct pipelines, which I will show you some data which represents a strong problem nowadays. From the side of the activities related to the anti-digital divide, what we have developed is something that nowadays is bringing wireless connectivity, has brought wireless connectivity worldwide. In this moment, we have funded the first internet service provider, which is owned by people in a form of an association. I will tell you also something about that. So, the activities that we have done worldwide between 2005, because it is true that the labs were funded in 2004, but we started operating in 2005. The activities that we have done worldwide to bring internet connectivity where there was not was performed here in the Amazonic jungle in the state of in the country of Ecuador. So we are located in South America. We won a project that was funded by the World Bank, and thanks to this project we brought internet connectivity to the area. Maybe you have read something. It is a very marginal area of the Amazonic forest, and in particular the part that is bordering to the tribes that are called the Red Men's, which are these people that are totally out of any technological development, and they live still in the jungle like 3,000 years ago. We didn't bring internet to them, we brought the internet in a very close area where there are almost already civilized people. Then we worked in this dot in the middle of the ocean where there is a country formed by three islands between Madagascar and Africa, and we have the archipelago of the Comoros Islands. The difference between these two projects is that here we have developed just a connectivity for some villages. Here we have built a network that was covering the whole country. So we had three islands, a total population of about 1 million people. Theoretically, all these 1 million people were provided with internet connectivity with the infrastructure built by us. We have worked in the desert. Okay, this is not considered to be as this point or this one something that is marginal in terms of the society, because we are speaking about the Arabic Peninsula. So here, obviously, as you can imagine, we have a lot of money, but still there are parts in the Arabic Peninsula where there is not internet connectivity. So you see ocean, forest, desert. What we have done in terms of mountains, we have done some experiments in the Monferrato region first, and then we have moved to the Alps, and we have constructed a system to bring internet on the top of the Monte Rosa. But let's go in order. So the first activity that has been done by these labs, it was in 2005, as I told you, and it was in the municipality of Rosa Boia, which is a place very close to the city of Torino. It is a municipality located about 60 kilometers from there. The idea was that in those years there was not ADSL connection anywhere in the rural Piedmont. The only proper ADSL was, we are speaking about 2005, so it was only 12 years ago, the only ADSL available was available in Torino. Mainly it was 640K. Many villages in Piedmont, about 1,000 municipalities, were still connected with the 56 kilobit per second modem. So it was really 12 years ago, but like 100 years ago in terms of the evolution of the telecommunication. So the experiment that we have done was this one. We believed that the normal Wi-Fi system, in 2005 we had the first Wi-Fi routers that were spreading around. We believed that it was possible to create a backbone, so the network that was able to bring internet connectivity from the city to the countryside using extremely low cost devices. And in particular, it was possible to use just the standard Wi-Fi routers that we can buy and use in our houses. So we did this. We took the picture is what it is, but you will see better pictures in the slides that will be distributed. We took an old computer. This was really an old computer. You see the devices, the hard disk that is just mounted there, the power supply, And then it was all dismounted because it was, we liked to show the single components of the machine. The mainboard is still there. And on the top of this mainboard, we just placed the wireless transceiver that we were taking out from a normal Wi-Fi router. The wireless transceiver has a cost, had a cost at that time, $1 per transceiver. A PC that was an old PC at that time, we used a Pentium 2, but it was something that, as you see, it was a part in the in a storage here in the Polytechnic. It was not anymore used for any other application. So we took this PC, we transformed it in a transmitter and receiver. We placed it in the town hall, and by cables, it was connected to an antenna, parabolic antenna, that was transmitting 30 kilometers distance to the mountains in here, the zone of Pornier, which is located very close to Torino, and from the mountains, we were transmitting back to Torino. So, two links. The cost was almost zero because we were just using recycled components, and thanks to this system we were basically able to distribute a connectivity in the town hall of 2 megabit per second. It was just a demonstration, obviously. We didn't want to generate a network using recycled components, but the idea was that it was possible to use a technology that is normally limited to the application in the house, you see, to bring internet connectivity from Torino to about 60 kilometers distance, to consecutive hops of 35 kilometers, because it was not a direct straight line, but we were jumping over the mountain. And this was the result. We then connected this system to a standard access point, a router Wi-Fi, and then we were distributing connectivity basically in the square in front of a town hall. It was, as I told you, a demonstration. The following year, we did something that was a bit more complex. Again, unfortunately, the representation of the picture is not extremely good, but you have to think that we were using the same kind of technology, starting from Torino, going to the same place, but in this case the transmission was direct, so there was only one link. And from there, we had several small hops that were used in order to create direct communications between the schools of several municipalities in the region of Monferrato. The result of the project was that by the use of the same technology, here you see an example of implementation where we have a pole, on the pole we have the antennas. The antennas are connected to the same kind of transmitters that were manufactured in the same way. We were able basically to interconnect these schools, and the bandwidth was in a way or the other, grown from 2 to 8 megabit per second. So every institute, every building belonging to these schools was provided with bidirectional 8 megabit capability. The idea was that the schools were using this connectivity, 8 megabit still is nothing to nowadays, but at that time, compared to the 56K, it was a lot. And these persons were using this kind of connectivity in order to provide the kids with the capability to generate, as you see, chatting and video chatting and group working from one school to the other one. So it was a kind of video conferencing, even if, you know, in 2006 without any kind of stable infrastructure, it was just a trial. But the idea was that the kids were working with this kind of video conferencing. Basically, what we have done, it was just a modification of the Wi-Fi protocol. Since you have not the proper background to understand this, I will just tell you very briefly. When you have an access point and you have some PCs, some station that are connected to the access point, station 1, station 2, station 3. For example, our terminals that are connected to the Wi-Fi network of the Politecnico, the Wi-Fi system is constructed in a way to be very democratic. So basically, the idea is that the access point is ready to transmit or to receive information from the station, and every station must have the same possibility to access the network. So there is a time initially where all the stations are trying to access the network. So for the moment, for an initial time, no stations are transmitting. Then there is, and it is called contention window. Then there is a time where every station, or at least one of the station, is admitted to use the channel. But the channel is unique. So you need part of the channel, part of the time, to define which is the station that has the right to transmit or to receive first. What does it mean? It means that you have a time here, and then again another time to allow another station to transmit or to receive. There is a time that is basically wasted, because all the stations, they have to do something in order to ask the access point the communication, and then the communication is established. I don't enter too much in the description of the communication protocol, but believe me, the only thing that we have done was to avoid all this democratic scheme, and we have basically established and enforced the rule. So we have two stations that are supposed to connect to the access point. Very well. Station number one has the right to transmit in a certain time slot. Then this time slot is dedicated only to station number one. When the transmission is finished, it doesn't matter if it has to fill all the time slot, or just half, or maybe it would need more, that its transmission is truncated to this point. Because there will be a second time slot where the transmission is for this station here. Maybe the station has nothing to transmit. It will be empty, doesn't matter, but it is dedicated to it. And then there is a third time slot dedicated to station number three. Station number one, station number two, station number three. When the time slot will be again for station number one, if there is something more to transmit, because, for example, the packet is not completed, it will be completed here. So the scheme that we have applied is quite complex, but the idea was this one. We removed the democracy, we established another kind of democracy that is based on the division in time, but in this way we were capable to manage the connection of several stations, even if they were very far from the first access point. With this limitation that is introduced by the standard Wi-Fi is basically the worst limitation in terms of accessing a network from a far distance. Okay, so this is the work that we have done. So it was not just a matter to recycle components and to integrate components, but from the side of the informatics, we have worked in order to optimize the communication protocol in order to be more efficient for the kind of transmission. So, using the same approach, actually just varying the time slots as a function of the distance, basically we did in 2007 a network that was covering almost all Europe, still with extremely low cost components. And the idea was that we were connecting the Politecnico di Torino to the Monte Rosa. The Monte Rosa is a mountain here that has an height of 4,556 meters. And the distance between Torino and the Monte Rosa is about 100 kilometers. The Monte Rosa was connected to the hills of Piacenza, which are located about 150 kilometers from the Monte Rosa. There was another link to Austria, in particular to the mountain of Valluga, that was ranging 220 kilometers, and then there was a further link between the Monte Rosa and the Monte Cimone that was ranging about 300 kilometers. Basically, the scheme, the realization scheme, was the same. The idea was to extremize the capability of these Wi-Fi routers in order to generate a communication that was about 300 kilometers. So we started with 100 and then we increased little by little during the spring 2007 until we reached the communication to the 2007. You see the kind of device that we were constructing. The difference from the first device that I have showed you is here. So basically, at that time we were using a mini PC, which is just a totally integrated PC on one single board. The idea was that we had to bring these devices on the top of the mountains. So it was not just a realization like in the town hall where we could deliver the components there. We needed to pack and to protect all the components and then to embed into boxes that were waterproofed and were capable to survive to extremely low temperatures, for example. So the realization scheme was absolutely the same, but the idea was a bit different in terms of realization, so a bit more professional. Still, professional, yes, but as you see, at least the transportation was still done with simple ways. It is true that this is a researcher in the Politecnico, but I always avoided for my PhD students to do risky things. So basically, the person behind the antenna on this chairlift was myself. And these were people mounting an antenna on the top of the hut, which was hosting our transmitters on the Monte Rosa. This is the picture that is showing the time where we did the first video conferencing between the Monte Rosa and the Monte Cimone, 300 kilometers, honestly 297 kilometers, but almost 300 kilometers. At that time, we were capable to transfer over 300 kilometers a bandwidth which was about 30 megabit per second. It is clear that this was just a demonstration, but it was demonstrating that even very long distances, it was possible to cover these distances with extremely low cost technology. So it was possible basically to work on realization that were sustainable in terms of the cost, for example, in other parts of the world. All these demonstrations that we have done in Piedmont, in the Rossa Boia first, in the Monferrato second, and then on the Alps, it was dedicated basically to this part. Anyhow, this is, you recognize, this is Linksys Wi-Fi router, and it was the highest Wi-Fi access point located in Europe, because it was on the top of the Sart, on the top of the Monte Rosa. You can imagine that it is difficult to find another place where you can connect to the internet with an almost proper technology as the one that we have done over there. Thanks to this activity that we have done, we were capable in 2008 to win a competition that was open to 80 participants, and it was a competition of the World Bank. They were funding projects for the South America. As I told you, we chose the Amazonic jungle and we decided to construct a network in the region of Puerto Francisco de Orellana. Basically, the idea was that we were starting from this city that more or less had the function of Torino in the network that we were synthesizing there. Here you see the Amazon River, or at least this is a river which is contributing into the Amazon. Maybe it is called El Coca, but it doesn't matter. It is basically the Amazon as a region. The city here was provided with a bit of technology, so basically they had some optical fibers, nothing which is which could be considered equivalent to what we can have nowadays, but it was still a bit of technology, and we helped the people locally to construct some infrastructures in order to bring the technology, for example, in a place like this. This is the village of Dayuma. You cannot recognize, but believe me, this is just a dirty road, so there is no asphalt. Houses are very minimal, and basically there was not any internet connection. There was not coverage by means of mobile phones, at least at that moment, and then mobile connectivity came, but not with the 3G. And basically, the idea was to replicate the same system in order to arrive there. Well, this was done just by helping the people. This is a moment where we are constructing a kind of a tower in the middle of the forest, in order to have antennas as high as 40 meters, in order to be outside the trees. And this is another moment where the local people were not engineers, they were studying our platform with a PhD student of mine that was teaching to them how to use, to configure the systems, and then to activate the network. Another kind of activity that we have done, it was done in the Comoros Islands. You see that in this place, houses, there is not a proper roof here, people were living in places like that. They had electricity, but unfortunately they had not the communication infrastructure. Also, the kind of the roads were very minimal here. Basically, we did something that was very similar to what we have done in the Amazonic jungle, but the difference was that we were in 2012, so we were able at first to put compact our transmitter in a smaller place, and we were also trying to work in terms of improve the sustainability. So, for example, here you can see the public phone, which is installed in the middle of the jungle. And you need coins, special coins that are sold in the city. So basically nobody in the jungle is able to use this phone because it is not possible to find the coins. Or you have an installation like this where our access point is inside this palm tree, inside of the leaves of the pine tree, and basically you have some chairs behind, and you have the possibility to go there and to use a computer and to connect to the internet for free. Now, the question you could pose is, but anybody has a computer there? Yes, because in the framework of the project, we provided the villages with some PCs that were capable to connect to the internet and to use the internet. So, you see that these are kinds of activities that we have done in order to overcome the problem of the digital divide worldwide. We have done something similar in also in the Monferrato region. Again, this is the village of Perola Savoia. Remember, the village where we started the very first experiment in 2005. And the idea is that this village is really nice as an experimental field because it is hilly. There is also a river, there are four valleys, So, to study the effect of the propagation of the electromagnetic the wireless signal is a really a nice place where you can analyze the efficiency of any kind of wireless system that you are going to implement. In fact, what we have done, and this was 2010, you see a projection of the heights of a village. So the blue is where the height above the sea level is lower, and the red is where the height above the sea level is higher. The black, white dots are houses. So, as I was telling you, you have houses almost everywhere over the whole surface of 20 kilometers square. You have some houses on the top of the hills. You have some other houses in the middle of the valleys, here for example, but here you have houses on the top, also here, here, and here. So basically, we decided to cover the whole village in this way. We synthesized some base stations, like the base station for that are used for the mobile phones. The difference is that these base stations were totally based on the use of modified Wi-Fi technology. And basically, the idea was to allow the connection to all the houses and not only to some schools or to some buildings, public buildings, like the town hall, like we have done previously. Every building was allowed to connect directly to one of these access points. We were providing at that time a bandwidth that was very high. You see, for example, a kind of installation here where parabolic equipment are used in order to deliver the bandwidth from one point to another one, and then you have antennas that are distributing in a sectorial way the internet connectivity all around. This was a pretty decent experiment where we were using the people of the village in order to test our devices. And we started in 2010. It was totally based on the availability of the people that were deciding to use the internet channel through ourselves and not through other people, because in the meanwhile, other operators were come. You see that in the first year we had almost 50 people participating to the experiment, but then the people grew and we terminated the experiment in 2014 with 255 families that were using only our system in order to connect to the internet. So it is a demonstration of reliability, because the people were trusting the capability of the system. Taking into account that the total number of families that are living in this village is equal to 650, but half these people are aging more than 70. So basically almost the 40% of the families were participating to the project, but let me tell you, the 80% of the people that know how to use internet. So basically a very high percentage compared to the possibilities offered by the market, if I can say something like that. The work that we have done there was in order to develop an infrastructure that was capable to bring this internet connectivity with a channel that was 10 megabit in download and 5 megabit in upload for all the participants. The possibility to distribute such a high bandwidth, even just with one single Wi-Fi transmitter, it was given by the adaptation of the Wi-Fi protocol that was still even more optimized in order to change these time slots, as I told you before, in order to obtain the maximum performance compared to the needs of the people. 10 megabit in download, 5 megabit in upload, with a total bandwidth that was brought to the village that at that time was about 100 megabit. So 100 megabit was enough to distribute 10 megabit per person, even if the participants were 255. Why? Because there is a superposition scheme. So basically the people were not using the same channel in the same time, and it was possible in this way, obviously, to optimize the total availability of bandwidth and to avoid that the bandwidth that should be brought on the place was 255 times the bandwidth that was given to every single person. Okay, so as you see, we have done several activities in order just to optimize the use of standard commercial equipment in order to develop the maximum bandwidth in for a reasonable price in terms of the construction of the infrastructure, and also obviously to generate something that was reliable and it was usable by the people. The further development of this infrastructure that we have created in Verona Savoia is the development of the first internet service provider owned by the people. So basically, when we terminated the experiment in Verona Savoia with these 255 participants, we collected the people all together and we proposed them to be owner on their own system. So they funded an internet operator, they called it Senza Fili, Senza Confini, which means wireless without borders. And basically, this network operator is a very strange thing in Italy, because it is the only operator which is not a commercial operator, but which is distributing internet connectivity just because of the fact that it is useful for the people that are owning the same operator. So it is basically an association of common people. These people are joining together, they are buying bandwidth, for example in Torino or in other places where there is optical fiber available, and then using Wi-Fi technology they distribute the bandwidth to themselves. So basically it's the institutional version of the experiment that we have done before. And basically, as you see, it is an association of people, it is configured in order to be a non-profit organization. In particular, it is devoted to the social promotion, so it is not just the operator that is distributing internet, but it is trying to use internet in order to promote the social system in the countryside. So, for example, the people, they organize courses, they organize activities in order to enroll also the elder people to use the internet, and they are succeeding because they are increasing even more the number of people that are adhering to the system. Obviously, it is also an internet service provider, and basically the idea is to try to do something different from the normal commercial activity in order to provide services, any kind of services, in this case internet, to the countryside. These are the performance registered by any user. So you see this ping time, which is the latency, the delay that is taken by the packet when it is transmitted from your PC to the internet, for example, requesting a Google call and back. 1 millisecond is extremely low, and it is the closer value possible to the optical fiber. Again, this was obtained by a series of optimization of the wireless link for the wireless communication by using the Wi-Fi. These are the standard values that they have, and typically the maximum is 12 and 8, and basically you see that more or less they do not reduce the total value, because in this case the guy was missing a very very little part to reach the maximum 12, and also here compared to the 8. So basically we call We call this system an anti-infrastructural divide system because obviously you are capable to provide infrastructural connectivity with a very adequate values to everybody, even in the countryside. When you speak about digital divide, there is always also a cultural divide. As I was telling you before, elder people are not capable to use the computer, so there is a problem originated also by the fact that even if you bring technology in a place, nobody assures that the people living in that place they have the possibility to use the technology because they never used the technology. So the people of the association are organizing courses to help mainly the kids in the schools or elder people to use internet communication and to use IT. And then the nice thing is that all this, since it is configured in a form of a non-profit operator, it is extremely cheap. So every people is accessing the internet in their house with the capabilities that I have told you, just by paying 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 80 euros per year. Because obviously there are no revenues, there are people that are participating to the management of the system, and so the cost can be reduced just to 80 euros. You can imagine nobody in Italy can offer the same kind of service for a very small price as that one. Speaking about social, we have the organization of the work in the association that is structured in this way. The people, the participants, the customers, if you want to call like that, but they are not customers, are managing the institution, they are managing the institution economically, from the side of the promotion, from the side of the assistance to the other people, from the side of the technological transfer, so also the teaching to the people and so on. We are hosting people graduated at the Polytechnico as engineers for the network management. They are employed, so it is nice because there is also a possibility for people to get a job. And then there are also the people that are managing the installation, so basically all those poles and masts that you have seen before. Basically, if you are not in the Amazonic jungle, you have to follow some rules, so only people that have the right accreditation can build up a pole or pose a mast. So for this reason, there is a collaboration with some local enterprises that are building and manufacturing the network. What is generating wireless in the countryside? For example, participation. Look at these people that are joining all together one of the assemblies of the association. At that time, the number of associates was about 300 and the participation was 250, so extremely high. And then there are a lot of activities that can be done by an internet service provider like this one compared to a pure commercial internet service provider, like for example TIM or Vodafone, because there are some agreements with the Catholic Church in order to distribute internet connectivity to the poor people when they want to connect and they want, for example, to visit the church. The activities with the schools that I have already told you. There is an agreement to do telemedicine with the hospitals of the area. There is another agreement with the social protection to provide an alerting system that is used in case of problems. Here we do not have earthquakes, but like in the center of Italy, but we might have problems with floodings and other things. So we are providing a lot of possibilities using the network in order to help the social protection and the civil protection to monitor and to alert the territory. And then there are some many other activities that are done for the people living in these rural places. I even told you about the mechanism of this association has grown little by little after 2014. From one municipality now, it is located in 16 municipalities. Let me show you something in terms of this is the growth, but I don't think you will see it very well, but you see the map that is increasing there with all these green and yellow parts are the number of municipalities that now have joined the association, and these red posts are the position of the access points in the area. Okay.
So what is the meaning, the difference between green and yellow?
This was because the green municipalities are fully operational, 100%. So the yellow are still under construction or partially under construction. So, for example, maybe a municipality needs three access points and only two are already operational, and one is missing. The idea is that we try to reduce the cost for constructing the infrastructure by an agreement with the Catholic Church and using the tower of the church, the tower bells basically. The only problem is that normally these are historical buildings, so every time you want to install even a very small antenna on an historical building, you need to ask the permission, and then you need to deposit an architectural project, as he knows very well, and basically this sometimes requires a bit of time. We are in Italy, we are not in the US, so the bureaucracy here is not Bulgarian, but almost. So sometimes you need a bit of time. But in any case, take into account that starting from the Rosa Boia, well, at the end of the experimental project, we were managing about six access points. Six access points, I'm not saying router Wi-Fi, the stations that I have shown you before. Now, over the 60 municipalities, we have already active 130 access points. Because the idea is to have a capillary distribution of these access points in order to provide the people connected with the best service. The total number of people that might be interested in the area is about 30,000 families living in the area that is associated to the operation of the association, and at this moment the people that are joining the association are about 3,000, so basically the 10%, which is a very nice penetration. In fact, statistically, I want to show you some facts. Sorry for this slide, which is not updated because it covers only to 1st of November 2016, but the one that is distributed, it will be updated to today. You will see that the line has grown again and it is now at 3,000. But one thing that is extremely nice to show you, statistically speaking, is this curve. This is the analysis of the growth in every single municipality, and the growth obviously depends on what? On the fact that in every different municipality we have started in a different month. So we have measured the growth starting from the month zero in a specific municipality, and we have normalized the growth trend to the number of families that work in that live in a specific municipality. So basically, the maximum will be 100%, and the minimum clearly is zero. Taking into account that we started operating not very much before, because month zero it was, for example, for the Rosa Boia at the end of the experimentation on January 2015, but in some municipalities some month zero was 2, 3, or 4 months ago. You can recognize that all these curves are growing, So this is a nice thing. It means that the people are satisfied, so nobody is leaving the association. But the other thing is that the slope of the curves is almost constant. We have made, apart from the initial phase, in some places we might have a very strong appealing in the very beginning, but still, after the initial phase, where we might start very strong or a bit lower, then you see that the curve that is increasing with the same slope. This slope is constant almost in every village, and it is equal to 1% per month. It means that the people are joining the association, 1% of the people leave almost, and there are some little differences from one month to another month, but mainly 1% of the people living in the village per month. In a way, I have discussed these trends with some colleagues that work on statistics, and they were telling me that we have discovered the law of the so-called speaking people to people. So basically, even if the association doesn't do any commercial activity, any marketing to spread the knowledge of the services around, just thanks to the fact that one citizen is speaking about his satisfaction to another citizen, these curves are growing little by little, but are still growing. 12% of the people living in the municipalities per year. And take into account that even in the Rua Savoy, thanks also to the teaching activity, still the curve that started, you remember, at 40% at the end of experimentation has grown again, and now it is almost reaching the 60% of the families living there. Still, with the growth that was about 12% per year. So obviously, at a certain point, these curves will stop, but in any case, it has been like that. Okay, this is an example of using academic competence, using wireless technology for social innovation. Basically, we fill the gap, which is not only a gap in terms of infrastructures, but it is a gap in general in terms of digital knowledge and digital content in a region that is normally considered of small or little interest by the standard telecommunication operators. This is an example. Now, I call the two guys and we show you another example which is mainly related to the construction of a more complex technology in order, as I told you, to reduce, for example, the use of the chemicals in agriculture, so still with something that has a strong social impact. Mattia is the electronics engineer, Giovanni is the informatics engineer, and now we show you what we are doing in our lab and what they are doing themselves. And then you have the possibility to see a lot of devices that we are manufacturing in the labs.
Okay, good morning to everybody. I'm Mattia, a researcher of XM Labs, the laboratory of Professor Brighero. And today we talk about Internet of Things. Okay, Internet of Things means objects that are related to the connection between measurement and connecting information. So if we have to collect some information about objects that we are use today, we have to speak about Internet of Things. In our case, we relate the Internet of Things to the precision farming. So the means of this project is to take information in the agricultural environment and then transmitting the information to the internet in order to let the information be accessible of by person. The goals of our project is to collect physical environmental parameters and measurement in order to detect diseases on plants. So if we have a problem related to a particular cultivation due to weather, to the weather, to diseases which attach and strike our cultivation, we have to detect and made some defenses against problems. The XM project, the Internet of Things XM project, wants to deploy many sensors in cultivation, which are called nodes, because the main structure of the platform are made by nodes, which are the wireless part of the Internet of Things project, of XM project. So we have many nodes displaced in the cultivation, connected to a different ambiental and environment sensor, like air temperature, air humidity, leaf weakness, soil temperature, soil weakness. So we can measure physical properties that are difficult to see only with eyes and by the farmers. Then we have to collect the data and put it on the internet to allow people seeing and analyze those data. We have an example. We have this is the API station, but not related to the Wi-Fi as said before, but to another type of communication. They called sub-gigahertz communication. We work instead of Wi-Fi, which work at 2.4 gigahertz, at 868 megahertz. So with a low bandwidth and a low frequency. But this low frequency allows us to transmit information with a low power management. So wireless sensor networks needs to be low power because we don't have a power supply in cultivation on in a wineland. And there is the necessity which the sensor doesn't need the help of people to work. So when you put and deploy a sensor, this sensor needs to work for 1 month, 1 year, many years. So it has to be low power. It has also to be long range because we have a vineyard which are really big. So we don't want many access points for any wineyard, but one access point with many sensors deployed on the wineyard. So the distance are not related to many kilometers, but many hundred meters. So 100, 500, 800, but nothing like a smartphone or home sensors, like I mean the air control, air temperature monitor for home automation are usable with this project. And also has to be waterproof because we have to deploy the sensor outside, so we can have rainfall or a problem with chemicals deployed by farmers. This is only a brief view of the functional scheme. We have the wireless sensor nodes deployed on the cultivation, an access point or gateway, so a thing that collect data from sensor and then publish them on the internet. And also we have, of course, the people who see and analyze the data from their PC or smartphone. The local network are made by a different architecture. We have chosen the Simplicity by Texas Instruments. I don't talk so many about difference between those platform, but in a brief view, we have the simpler deployment of technology, the long range platform for distributing wireless sensor node, and a new point of view for Internet of Things. So merging wireless sensor nodes and 3G communication of the smartphone. Okay, we start from a module which is already made by a third-party labs, which is CISECO. They made this module at 800 and 400 MHz to communicate between gateway and wireless sensor modes, and start prototyping sensor and measurement nodes from this module. But after some times and after some tries with many sensors, you can see the camera, which is the main project of this researching, which is made by sensors which only capture an image sensor, and then after capturing an image, we have to send it not through a standard connection like Wi-Fi or 3G, but with a platform which is not made for transmitting high data rate and high amount of data. So we have to manufacturing all of the board to allow this type of connection. You can also see the leaf witness and soil temperature sensor, the higher temperature and higher humidity, and the gateway, which is connected to the internet through a simpler USB to 3G modem. Here you can see the manufacturing and the design of the sensors. This is the last implementation of access point, which has a new module made by us, radio module made by us, so we don't take any more components from other third-party industries, but we are all made this module in our laboratory. So we have the radio module, a module which can collect information from a weather station, so air direction, wind speed, rain gauge, and temperature and humidity. We have the managing of USB modem, USB to 3G modem, and also all of the part which handle the power management of the board. Under this module, you can see there is a SBC, single PC board, which is the Raspberry Pi, maybe all of us knows, which is the simpler way to implement a real-time strategy with a real-time OS to collect data from a different type of network, which is not the web network, and then collect, organize, and publish the data on the internet. Here you can see the radio module made by us, the MSP4030, which is a microcontroller from Texas Instruments, which handles the weather station. The real-time clock, which is the part who verify data in order to compare the hour, the time which the data are taken with the time which is now on the internet, so to understand if some data are taken in a past moment. Here there is the last design of camera. Next I will show you also the PCB. Okay, this is the a picture that shows how the complex is a PCB which with this behavior, because we have a lot of components and we don't want a big packaging for a thing that have to be deployed in a farm. So there is something strong and little in order to put near a plant. You can see many components because we have to handle different things. So the power management, the solar panel which have to recharge battery, the power management of the two IC, the integrated circuits, which has the radio module and the module which handle the image processing from the image sensor. And this is the last project now, which is under construction in these days, which is the multi-sensor. So a single PC board, so a single thing, which it's capable to measure different things like the leaf and soil weakness and temperature, the high temperature, the high humidity. It's capable to measure the instant power from a different system. So if we want to monitor the health of a battery, like the 12 volt battery of our cars, we can use this this module to monitor the life of a battery. Any digital sensor an aftermarket, which have a connection like a URT or I2C bus, and also the meteo station that I said before, so the anemometer, rain gauge, and wind direction. In future development, we use the new module from Texas Instruments, which is this one, which is new and update version of the one which use now. It has a lower power demanding and a greater bandwidth. So we have to think about more different and better results we can achieve with this new sensor. Of course, after all of this hardware part which I now present you, there is the informatic and web part, which is made by my colleague Giovanni, and during his time I will show you the Apollo.
While they prepare, I want to tell you something that demonstrates the importance sometimes of the application of the technology to social innovation. You can imagine that if you are cultivating fields and you wanted to deploy some technology like this one, you have to spend money. So theoretically, it means that to introduce technology in a cultivation, it means that the cultivation will produce something, the good, the product, and the product will be more expensive. This is not true, and you can imagine this. It has been demonstrated in during our experiments that two sensors are enough over 1 hectare of terrain in order to reduce the number of chemical agents to 1/2. So it means that you implement the technology in a vineyard, you spend for the technology, but let's consider that one gateway with the camera and with the two environmental sensors might cost about 500 euros. And in average, the treatments, the chemical treatments that you use over 1 hectare of terrain, it costs about 900 euros per season. So if in 1 year you are capable to save 450 euros, you are not only producing something that is more natural, so it might have an added value, because typically a production that is more natural is you can sell it for a higher price. But also, the money that you have saved in terms of avoiding the chemicals are the same money that you have paid the first year to buy and to implement the technology. So in this way, in practice, you are not wasting any money, and your product will be valued more. So this is the idea. And very often the technology has this added value. Obviously, there is a chemical engineer here, so don't tell this to companies that are producing chemicals, this is for sure. But in general, this is it. Okay. So we have 5 minutes more to show the interface. It is nice. We are going also to see some pictures.
The interface.
Okay. But connected also?
Yes.
And we are connected to the camera that is acting now?
Yes.
Okay. So we are going to see a camera that is recording images now in a real media.
Okay. I will skip all the presentation about the software interface because it's pretty much boring actually. I want just give you an idea of how all the infrastructure works. It's not so complicated because we simply have the network, which are done by sensors, and they are separate. Every installation is a piece of the network. And all the installations do not work with each other. They don't need to interact. So basically, we have a software on the Raspberry, which is a single component MC, that collected information from the wireless sensor network. This information then are forwarded to the network, the internet, that you guys probably know. We do this using a gateway component, which is basically a software that forwards information. These are the technologies used. They are standard technology used in many fields. And there are many things to say about this because we have to solve many problematic concerning the aspect of the project. For example, one is that we do not have the internet connection every time, so the old component must be fault tolerance. But I would like to go on. So then we have a backend which is in charge of store all the information into the cloud. And already you probably know what is cloud because it's used in many aspects of our lives. But what I would like to show you is the front end.
because it's pretty much more interesting, so you can see something. The front end is basically a dashboard that you can use to show, to see information. And it's done with technologies that you guys probably don't know but use every day. For example, React is a software developed by Facebook that powers Instagram, for example. So we are using all these kind of technologies all together in order to give to the farmers, but not only the farmers, but more the agronomists, all the information that they need to choose what kind of strategy use on their field, on their culture. Okay, I would like to show you some data, for example.
So now we are connecting to the to a camera which is deployed in the vineyard.
Yeah. Okay. It was another. Okay. This is only the main interface. As you can see, we have this is an access point which is connected at 9 of this morning, the last time. It's now offline because it goes offline every time in order to save battery.
So there is a strategy here in order to minimize the power consumption. So basically, you have to imagine that all the devices are switching on just on demand. And you think that when you measure some environmental parameters, or maybe you want to take a picture of a plant, it is something that you are not requested to do every second because the plant is there and it does not modify. So basically, the idea is that you take a picture, you transmit the picture, and then all the infrastructure is going to sleep.
This is, for example, a graphics of the rain. As you can see, this night there was some rain there, and you probably have been wake up from this. At least at 3 a.m. of this night, I've been wake up from this rain tonight. Is that true? This is a daily graph that showed the amount of rain that the metro station collected, and we can go, for example, yesterday.
Is this data public?
No. They are only public to who can see the data, for example, farmer and agronomist associated with that farmer.
Unless the owner of the field would like to publish his own data, because it is the thing is that we have no control to what the farmer decides to do with his own data. Okay, so you might find somebody that is interested to publish this data in a public way. But this is left to the farmer, basically.
We can easily open this data to the world. It's absolutely easy. We have just to uncheck the options. But as you can imagine, there can be some kind of reservation. Okay. Maybe I can show you some photo. This is the zone.
When the device is applied in a private place, obviously we have devices that are under trial in public places. These are open, obviously. It depends on the place where the device is applied.
Okay, this is a camera that is basically not very far from us. It's
100 kilometers
from where we are. I can show you some photo.
In a few days, there will be another public in Montalcino, but it will be next week. So.
Okay, let's see some. Okay, during the night you can see. Okay, 6 a.m. we are already light. the image is not very.
The projection, I can tell you something. If you go on the website of our labs, which is xm.polito.it, there is a video which is constructed by Tavis Labs, and you see. I could project here, but actually the quality of the projection is so bad that I prefer to suggest you to do on your own, on your PC. You will find the construction of a video that shows 1 hour after 1 hour the change in color of the grape from green to red in the second part of August. And actually, Mina, we like it very much of this video because it's nice to see. I know that from an agronomical point of view, there are also some things to understand behind, I don't know, but it is still nicer to see. So I suggest if you have a 1 minute time
to
go on the website.
It is not really nice to see because of the projector, but as you can see, for example, you can see that all the pictures are done by the same perspective. This means that we can use some image processing tool in order to alert if we see something strange, for example, some colors can be used in order to understand if there are some infections, because we can compare the food. And obviously, taking in mind the time on the phone, people, morning, night, or in those colors change. But it's absolutely something you can do. It's not so complex. This is obviously a test installation, so you cannot see any details in this picture, but it's just a proof of concept.
Actually, there are. We know that the agronomists apply the camera in three different ways. As you see here, just to see the vineyard. So basically, from what I understood, they analyze the color of the leaves, and if some greens are less or more greens than others, it means that there are some problems in terms of the growth of the plant during the season. Or they can investigate just one single plant, and then over the plant they compare the differences between, for example, the top and the bottom, things like that, or they can observe the single leaf or the single grape. And then they have other kind of understanding that, I mean, I'm not the agronomist, so I cannot tell you exactly, but the idea is to have just one single object, which has the capability without any sun to live for 1 week, taking a few pictures a day. So we imagine the same resolution of the iPhone, but to live one iPhone for 1 week, taking pictures, it's going to be absolutely impossible. With much smaller battery, by the way, and everything is extremely compact and simple to install, and everybody can do it. Because one of the very important things that you have to take into account when you want to implement technology, and you want to, in a way or the other, to help the people, is absolutely to construct something that is ergonomic, easy to install, easy to manage, immediate, because otherwise the people won't use it. And this is something that has taken the majority of the time for them in terms of creating the correct design. We had many other things to show, but I mean the time is done. So if you are interested to visit our lab, you are absolutely welcome. We are in the other bit over there, the third floor. So anybody that wants to visit us and to see some other projects that we are working on, it is absolutely welcome
yes.
to our place.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.